Good afternoon, everyone. I am Harsh Oza. I am one of the coordinators of Syscon Talks group. So as a part of this initiative, we invite different faculties from broad research areas of systems controls, data science, and optimization. So today we have with us is Dr. Gugan Thuppe from IISc. So I'll just give a brief introduction about him. So Dr. Thuppe is a probabilist whose research interests are in stochastic approximation and random topology and their applications to reinforcement learning, communication and network engineering and data analysis. He is currently an assistant professor in computer science and automation department at IISc. Before this, he did two postdocs, one in Technion, Israel and the other at Duke, USA. He received his degree from TIFR Mumbai, where he was given the best thesis award. So we are glad to have you, Dr. Thuppe, with us. So now I would give the stage to you, so you can start with your talk.
Hello.
Yes, Professor, you are audible.
Okay. Thank you. So thanks a lot for the introduction and thanks for the invitation. So I'm happy to give this talk. So as I said before, okay, so I'm going to write on my slides. Okay, so because of this reason, it will be difficult to keep my video on as well as write. Okay, so I may be switching off my video soon. Okay, so before I advance with my talk, I would like to say that, you know, I'm happy to give this talk and during this talk, feel free to stop me. Okay. Whenever you feel like, and if you want a quick clarification, if the answer is short, I'd be happy to give it. If the answer is long, maybe I can give a short answer, and maybe at the end of the talk, we can elaborate a bit on that. Is that okay? All right. Is it okay if I start, Harsh?
Yes, Professor.
Okay, thank you. So please feel free to call me Gugan. Okay. All right. So let me stop my video and start my presentation. Okay, so I'm using this different software, okay, for writing on screen. So because of this reason, the software some reason doesn't have a nice full screen, but nevertheless we will work with what we have. Okay, so today's talk. Okay. So can you just confirm if you can see what I have written on the screen?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, thank you. All right, so today's talk is called as Online Algorithms for Estimating Page Change Rates. Okay, so my name is Gugan Thuppe and I'm an assistant professor in the Indian Institute of Science. And this is joint work with Konstantin Evrechenkov and Kishore Patil. Okay, so these are my collaborators from Indria Sofia. Okay, so this is an institute in France. All right, okay, so maybe I can begin by giving a quick summary of our work. Okay, so if I just had to take one slide to explain what we have done in this work, so here is such a summary. Okay, so I'm sure everyone knows what a web page is, and it's not difficult to see that different web pages, okay, change at different frequencies, right? Like for example, if you look at a website such as Crickinfo, especially when a cricket match is going on, so I hope you agree that such a web page keeps changing very quickly or at a very high frequency. Similarly, let's say we look at this web page related to this Bombay Stock Exchange. Okay, so I'm sure you also agree that this web page also has a very high frequency of change. On the other hand, here are some examples of web pages that change very slowly, right? Like they have a very low frequency of change. For example, the university's admission criterion, right? Let's say there is a page related to what is the criteria to enter IITB, right? So this page, there will be some people or some professors will come together, formulate some rules, like this is how the admission criterion has to be conducted. And, you know, there will be some people from the HRD ministry who will come and, you know, agree upon, okay, this is the criterion that will be there. And then once this criteria is decided, this criteria will be put on this web page. And it's not very likely that this will change very frequently, right? So maybe the next time such a big meeting happens, it is only that time that, this page may change. So you can see that some pages change very frequently, or they change at high frequency. Other, on the other hand, there are some web pages, okay, that change at a very low frequency, right? So our goal is to basically estimate for a given web page at what rate is it changing, okay? That's our goal. And in this paper, we actually provide three online algorithms for estimating these change rates, okay? And the first algorithm is actually based on the law of large numbers. The second algorithm is actually based on what is called as the theory of stochastic approximation, okay? So in this talk, whenever I say SA, it will by default imply that I'm talking about stochastic approximation. Right, and the third algorithm is basically this second algorithm, which is built upon using the theory of stochastic approximation, and we will add some additional momentum term to it. Okay, so these are the three algorithms that we discuss in this talk. Right, and apart from this, we also provide in our paper, as well as we will see this loosely in this talk as well, that we will also talk about the convergence and convergence rates of these algorithms. And finally, based on how much time we have left, I will try and go through some of our experiments based on both real data as well as simulated data. Okay, so this is what we have done. So a page changes at some rate, and we want to estimate that rate. Okay, and we have come up with three online algorithms based on law of large numbers, stochastic approximation, and momentum, right? And we have some theoretical guarantees on convergence and convergence rates, and then we have some experimental results that concern both simulated as well as real data. All right. Okay, so here is a quick background. Okay, so this background is related to this topic called as web crawling. Okay, perhaps some of you have heard of what web crawling is, and some of you may not, but here is a quick recap of what that is. All right, so so the World Wide Web is gigantic. Okay, so this is not a surprise. So what does gigantic mean? It means that there is a lot of interconnected information, and this information and links keep changing. Okay, so this information across the web is stored in the form of web pages. Right, so there are a lot of web pages, and these web pages are interconnected, and the information on these web pages and the links keep changing. Right, so this is a very challenging situation. However, when you go to a search engine, let's say like Google, or maybe some of you are more security conscious, so maybe you go to DuckDuckGo, or maybe do something like Bing and so on and so forth. Okay, so you don't concern yourself with these challenges. Okay, you expect as a user that the search engine, whenever you put in a keyword, it should provide you with instantaneous results, and at the same time, it should provide you with accurate and up-to-date results. Okay, so just to give you an example, if you go to Google and type the score for today's match, right? So you don't expect Google to provide you score for some other match that was held maybe, let's say, 2 or 3 days back, right? So you don't expect that. You expect that the Google actually provides you up-to-date information. Similarly, if you go on Google and search for, let's say, the stock prices of some stock, then again, you expect that Google provides you accurate and up-to-date information. You would not like stale information. Right, so if you put these two things together, I hope you are able to appreciate the enormity of the problem. Right, so there is information that keeps changing, but the user is not concerned, and he expects quality search results. Right, so how does a search engine do this? Right, so the search engine does this in the following way. So like a Google or something like that, okay, it doesn't, whenever you put in, the name of some website, like let's say ClickInfo, okay, it doesn't go to the actual server where, the actual copy of ClickInfo is uploaded. Okay, instead, what it does is it has a local cache, right? So it has a local cache, meaning it has a local database. And in this local database, Google will actually keep downloading versions of these different web pages. Is this okay? And since the quality of these search results is determined by the freshness of this local database or local cache, okay, so what do I mean by fresh? A local copy of a page is said to be fresh if it matches the original copy, right? So maybe here is a picture, there is a server, right? So let's say here you user is present, maybe you, and then there is a local database that is close to you that Google operates. Right, so now when you request Google to provide you some information, okay, it's not like from the server this page is fetched. Instead, what happens is, so this is not what is done. Instead, what happens is before the user actually queries, a local copy of this page is actually downloaded on the local database. So whenever a user puts in a query, okay, the results are actually serviced from the local database. Okay, that's the reason, these results are available to you in a flash of a pan, right? So it's not like, the server, this search engine actually goes and fetches the page and then provides to you. It actually gets this information from the local database, and that's the reason it is able to provide you this information very quickly, right? However, this local database, the information that is there, it has to be kept as fresh as possible, right? Otherwise, when you search something, okay, it will provide you with stale information, right? And as I said, what does fresh mean? A local copy of a page is fresh if it matches the original copy, right? So if there is an original copy over here, okay, sorry about this. So let's say there is an original copy over here, right? So and then there is a local copy here, right? So this local copy is said to be fresh if this and this copies actually match. Is this okay? So how does a search engine go about keeping this local cache as fresh as possible? Okay, and for this purpose, a search engine makes use of a crawler. Okay, so this is also called as a web spider or a web robo or something like that. All fancy names are given, but the job of this crawler is to basically visit different web pages and come back and update this local cache. Is this okay? So more formally, what does a web crawler do? Okay, so it's a piece of code, okay, whose duties include the following. Okay, so web crawler, okay, will keep crawling the world wide web, and it will try and discover new pages that keep coming up. Like for example, let's say tomorrow you decide to maintain a professional web page of yours, and so far maybe you did not have one, right? So maybe you make use of some professional services, create a web page and put it online, right? So as soon as it comes online, somebody has to figure out that this has come online. Okay, that's the job of the crawler. Right, so it will keep crawling here and there, and it will figure out, okay, there is a new web page here, and it will download a local copy of that onto the local cache. Is this okay? Now, this is the first of the responsibilities of a web crawler. The second responsibility is that it tries to access various web pages at certain frequencies to detect changes. Right, so let's go back to the example of your own web page. Okay, so let's say at some point your profile changed, like for example you graduated, or maybe you won an award, or maybe one of your papers got published, or maybe you got an internship, so you want to update it on your web page, and so on and so forth. So whenever life changing event happens, you would like to update your web page, right? So this, once the web page is updated, the local copy that is there on the local cache and the place where you have uploaded your web page, right, the server or the cloud services where you have uploaded the web page, there will be a mismatch, right? So at some point this crawler has to come back, okay, figure out that there has a change, and once it detects a change, it will download the updated copy back onto the local cache. Is this okay? So so the second task is to visit different web pages at certain frequencies to detect changes, and the third is update the local cache if a change is detected. Okay, so the focus of this work, that is the work that I'm going to describe today, okay, will be mainly on tasks 2 and 3. Okay, so we will not concern ourselves with discovering new web pages. Is this okay? All right, so far so good. Okay, so the story so far is that there are several web pages. These web pages keep changing, right? And the job of the crawler is to make sure that whenever a page gets updated, okay, the fresh copy is downloaded onto the local cache. So what's the challenge? Okay, so the challenge is that you cannot keep doing this repeatedly, or you cannot do this task several times in a day. Like for example, you can't visit a web page several times to check if it has changed. Like maybe you visit your web page, right, which maybe doesn't get updated very frequently, but let's say the search engine decides to visit it every few seconds to see if something has changed. Okay, something has changed, let me download the copy, Right. So all this actually consumes bandwidth, right? However, we don't have infinite bandwidth available. So there is some limited bandwidth that is available. Furthermore, there is something called as a politeness constraint. Okay. So some servers, okay, in order to, make sure that resources are available for important tasks, okay, will not respond to your queries all the time. Right, so this is what is referred to as a politeness constraint, which means that you may have a query and you go and ask this server, oh, has this page changed, right? So and you keep doing this. Now politeness constraints means that the server will put some restriction saying that the average rate at which you can ask me questions is this, right? So maybe 100 pings per minute or something like that, right? Or 100 pings per hour, something like that. I don't know the official numbers. I'm just making these up, right? So there will be some constraint like this. And if you exceed these constraints, okay, the server may actually decide to ban you. Okay, so it is very important that, when we design web crawlers, they actually, make sure that these constraints are satisfied, right? So given these responsibilities and these constraints, it is clear that, both this put together can be viewed as an optimization problem. Okay, so what is the optimization problem? The optimization problem is that we would like to maximize the freshness of the local cache subject to the crawling frequency. So by crawling frequency mean, this crawler has to visit different web pages. Okay, how many times does it visit this web page in a given unit interval of time, right? That is what is called as the crawling frequency. And this constraint says that this crawling frequency cannot be very high. Right, so that's the optimization problem, that the crawler has to maximize the freshness of this local cache subject to the crawling frequency being within some prescribed bounds. Is this okay? So this is the optimization problem that is there. Okay, so given this optimization problem, let's try and ask what has been done so far. Okay, so if you actually scan the literature, okay, some of the papers which have received the maximum citations will be this Cho and Garcia, and then there is also this paper by Edwards. Okay, so I think there is a typo here. If I'm not wrong, this would be a 2001 paper. Is this okay?
Gugan, can I ask a question?
Sure, go ahead, Ashley.
Yeah, so my question is it's a very basic one. Sometimes we see that when you search Google, there is a time that is written 0.19 second or something like that. Yes. Is it related to the crawling frequency somehow?
So I think that is based on how much time it took to fetch those results, right? So as I said, there are two parts to this, right? So there is the local cache being updated, and then there is the time required to fetch the results and show it to you on the screen. Is this okay? Now, the crawling part is only done to ensure the freshness of the cache. Right, this crawling has nothing to do when you search. Like when you search, this search engine will look at the local database and provide you results. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, that I understand. But, let me ask a very naive question. Basically, suppose I search a string of words, let's say, Google then try to, for example, match those with the caches that they have and try to find out which cache is the most fresh and try to match that with the website. Is that the process?
So maybe I don't know the formal details because my background is not in search engines, but from what I have read so far, the answer to this is that so there is a local server that will be close to you, right? Like, so maybe if you live in Mumbai, the Mumbai region will be serviced by some Google server that is close to you, right? So when you put in a query, Google actually will go and search in that local database and provide it to you, right? Now, it is possible that, you put in some query, like a very strange looking query, right? Like, let's say, some keyword and some keyword with which there is no match. So if you put that, maybe the local cache, may not have any hit. By hit, I mean that maybe there are no results that match your query, right? And in that case, maybe if you query several times, maybe, the Google next time onwards may try to pull in some more data related to this query. And maybe if you query after a couple of days or something, maybe you get some more results. So that is something that could happen. Okay, but this is, I'm making a guess. I'm not very, familiar with how search engines and all work. Is that okay?
Yeah, thank you.
All right. All right. Okay, so far so good. Okay, so now as I said, let's actually quickly go over this previous work. Okay, so the previous work, if you sort of you know, go on Google Scholar and try to search you know, these keywords, then you'll see that some of the most cited papers are this works by Chua and Garcia and Edwards and others. Okay, so they did actually some experiments, okay, to figure out what is the optimal frequency of crawling a page, right? So it is clear that some pages change very frequently and some pages, you know, change very slowly. So as a search engine, what should be the strategy that the search engine should adopt, okay, to determine how frequently should a given web page be crawled, right? So that's the job of this crawler to figure out, so that it can maximize the freshness of this local cache, right? So what they assumed was in this works, if you actually go and read, so the summary is that they assume that each page is equally important. Okay, so when they assume that each page is equally important, they found that the optimal crawling policy, by that I mean the policy which ensured the maximum freshness of the local cache, okay, so that policy was crawl all pages at the same frequency irrespective of their change rates. Is this okay? So what it says is that you know, maybe there is some page which changes very, very frequently, and maybe there is some web page which changes very slowly. So ignore the change rates, go and visit every frequency at regular intervals of time, right? And you know, update your you know, your local cache, and you will notice that you know, by you know, crawling all pages at the same frequency, the freshness of this local cache is maximized. Okay, so there is some formal way of defining what freshness of a cache is, but locally it means that you know, on an average, whenever a user requests some data, okay, related to some web page, you are able to provide him the fresh copy, right? Like, let's say you ask score of today's match, right? So each time you ask this, the search engine should provide you with the fresh copy, right? Or in other words, the local copy that the search engine is serving to you should match the actual copy or the original copy. So whenever it is able to do that, it managed to serve you a fresh copy, right? And when it doesn't manage to do that, it managed to serve you a stale copy. So the freshness is maximized when as many requests as possible are served with fresh copies and not stale copies. Does that make sense? So that's loosely the way of defining freshness of a cache. And what these experiments show is that irrespective of the rates at which these web pages change, okay, you should crawl all pages at same frequency. So in some sense, this is a bit surprising, right? So this was indeed very surprising, and the reason why this optimal crawling frequency came out to be this is because they assumed that all web pages are equally important. Okay, so starting from this 2003 work, okay, instead what they assumed was they had different weights for different web pages. Okay, so these different weights could depend on how frequently requests are made to a particular web page. Right, so maybe, you know, for a Crick Info, there may be several requests per day when a match is going on. So indeed, that web page is very important. On the other hand, you know, there could be a web page, let's say, you know, one that prescribes the admission criteria. So maybe it doesn't have several hits on most of the days. So consequently, that web page may not have a high weight. Right. So in this sense, you introduce different web pages for different web pages depending on the importance. So this importance is something that is subjective, but you define some notion of importance and then you assign different weights. Okay, and what was the motivation for doing this? The motivation for doing this was that only a finite number of pages can be crawled in a limited amount of time, right? Because the number of web pages keeps exploding, okay, this optimal policy cannot be you know, used always, right? Because you cannot crawl all the pages that are there in the World Wide Web, because there are just too many pages, right? So that's why you have to figure out which pages to crawl and which to ignore, and you know, that is based on this notion of importance, and that importance is reflected in the weight that we assign to each web page. Okay, and in such a situation, that is when you have different weights for different web pages, right, the experimental evidence, okay, was more in tune with our intuition, okay, that the optimal policy actually, so by optimal policy, it means that the rate at which a web page, the rate at which a web page should be crawled. Okay, so this is what policy means. Policy means that different pages will require different rates at which it should be crawled. So we have to figure out these rates, right? And these rates at which the crawling frequency at indeed depends on the page change rates. Okay, so this is more in tune with our intuition. Is this okay? So all this was experimentally done. Okay, so both this was experimental work. Okay, however, there was a recent work by Azar and others. Okay, so this was a 2018 work. So they actually, you know, mathematically formulated this problem, and they rigorously showed that the optimal policy indeed depends on the page change rates. Okay, and they actually provided a near linear time solution to find a near optimal solution. So here, optimal solution means the optimal crawling frequencies for each page. Okay, which means that if you have a certain web page, the crawler will know at what frequency it should crawl. This page should be crawled so that this local cache is kept as fresh as possible. Okay, however, the issue with this work is that they assume prior knowledge of page change rates. Okay, that is the key issue. So they assume that the rate at which a page changes, this information is already available to this this optimization problem, right? And consequently, you know, they figure out the optimal crawling frequencies based on these actual page change rates. Okay, so clearly this is unrealistic, because a priori one will not know at what rate a given page may change, right? So as a human being, maybe you may be able to guess, but as a search engine, okay, or a web crawler, okay, if I just give an arbitrary web page, okay, unless it visits these web pages several times to collect data, and only based on data it will be able to guess how fast or how slowly will this page change. Okay, and other than that, there was also this recent work by Avrachenkov and Borker. Okay, so they also proposed some algorithm to figure out some optimal crawling policy, and their algorithm is actually based on the idea of Whittle indices, right? And they said that they actually adaptively change the crawling frequency based on the page freshness estimate. Okay, so in their algorithm, right, so you will have this estimate of how fresh a given page is, and this use this to adaptively change the crawling policy. However, even their algorithm actually needs knowledge of actual page change rates. Okay, so the summary of these two works is that, you know, they have some nice ideas, but they assume that the rate at which different web pages change, okay, this is actually known to the algorithm, or at least there is a nice estimate that is available. Okay, so this is unrealistic, and this is what is the focus of our work. Okay, so this then brings us to this question of what is our goal, what are our constraints, and what are our contributions. Okay, so we focus on a single web page, right? So in these problems, yes, go ahead.
So in the second work that you discussed, you said that each page can have different importance, and the number of times a crawler visits that page should depend upon the weight that it puts on the importance of the page, right?
It depends on the weight as well as the rate at which the page changes.
Yeah. So mm-hmm. So the importance of a page also changes, right? Like when we talk about a particular web page, let's say you were talking about the cricket web page, some website mm-hmm. you were talking about.
Yeah.
So that can have different importance depending upon whether the match is between which countries or whether the match is happening or not.
That is right. So that's a good question. I mean, as you can see, these are very recent works, right? I mean, this is a 2003 work, but in 2018 and 2020, these are very recent works. So they look at the case where the weights do not change with time. Okay. And so this is a realistic assumption over a short period of time, but over a long period of time, indeed, the weight of pages may also change. So you are right, but in these papers, they assume that the weights do not change. Is this okay? But indeed, that is an important case to consider.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, sure. Okay, so so now we can ask what is the goals, the constraints that and contributions that we make. Okay, so the goal is that we only focus on a single web page, and we are interested in developing an online algorithm for estimating the rate at which this single web page changes. right? And the constraint is that we only have access to partial information. So what do I mean by that? We only get to know if a page has changed or not, okay, since the last crawled instance. So what do I mean? So let's say this is the timeline, and maybe the page changes here, maybe the page changes here. So this is the time at which the page changes. So maybe it changes here and so on, right? So maybe there are several changes here and so on. So let's say you visited the page at this time, and let's say the next time you visited this page, right? So you won't come to know that there were two changes or this page was changed twice. All you will come to know is that this page got modified at least once. That's all you will get to know. And the way you can do it is, let's say you have a version of the previous copy. You go to the web page now and you check if the current copy matches with your old copy. If it matches, then the page has not changed. However, if it does not match, then you can figure out that this page has changed. However, you will not come to know how many times this web page has changed. Is that okay? So because of this reason, we say that this the algorithms that we design have access only to partial information, meaning they will only get to know if a page has changed or not, but not the number of times the page may have changed between two crawling instances. Okay, so quick summary, just 1 minute, I'll just finish this. So the contributions that we make is, we make use of law of large numbers and stochastic approximation theory to develop three algorithms, and we provide convergence and convergence rates, and we also experimentally validate their performance on real simulated data. Yes, go ahead, Ashif.
Yeah, my question is, how the search engine, for example, that yes. will try to save some caches of the changing page, right? Like, yes. For example, yes. in some regular interval or something like that. So it may not actually find the exact number of changes, for example, right? So even the search engine that I'm searching doesn't know exactly how many times a page has changed, right?
That's right. But nevertheless, so it is true. I mean, we are designing a web crawler for a search engine, right? So it is true, whatever you are saying, and using only this available information. So this is an assumption that a search engine this is a constraint that even a search engine has to face. If that is what you're saying, I agree with that, right?
Yeah, yeah. Another question I have is, I don't know whether it's within your domain. Does the search engine try to save as many of catch pages as possible for a particular website, or they just delete the previous ones by taking the count of how many times the change has happened?
So that, if you actually go visit, use Google search, and if you search, so if you actually see close to the link, you will see an arrow, and if you click on that, there will be a cached copy available. Right?
Yeah,
so
yeah,
indeed, there is like some version that is stored, but I don't know how many versions are stored. Okay, so that I'm not sure.
Yeah, maybe the latest versions or few latest version.
Possibly, but I don't know how many versions are stored. Is this okay?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so now let's begin the formal analysis. And one of the key things that we require is what is called as a Poisson point process. Okay, so let me quickly recall for everyone what a time homogeneous Poisson point process on this set 0, infinity means. Okay, so let's say we have a time homogeneous Poisson point process on 0 infinity with rate delta. What does this mean? This means you have a random sequence of points in this set, such that the following things are true. So what is the first one? So let's say I give you any measurable subset of this interval 0 infinity with this notation denoting its length. Like, for example, A could be the interval C comma D, right? Then the length of this is D minus C. Okay, so the length or Lebesgue measure, whichever you are familiar with. Okay, so let's say we have been given such a measurable set, right? And for that, let's define this N of A. Okay, N of A is the number of these points. Okay, so observe that these are T0, T1, these are your points. So the number of points that lie in A. Is this okay? So this will be a random variable because this sequence of points is random. Is this okay? So you have a random sequence of points in 0 infinity. So I fix a set A and I ask how many of these points actually fall in this set. Okay, and for a Poisson point process, this random variable will have a Poisson distribution, okay, with mean delta times the length of this set A. So what does that mean? If you look at the probability that n of a equals k, that is the number of points that fall within this set A, this number equals k, okay, this will be given by e raised to minus delta times the length of A times delta times the length of A raised to k by k factorial. So this is just the formula for a Poisson distribution. Okay, that's all. Okay, so so we will say we have a time homogeneous Poisson point process if this condition is satisfied. Furthermore, for mutually disjoint sets A1 to AM, we require that these random variables also be mutually independent. Okay, so there are two things for a Poisson point process. One is that it should have a Poisson distribution, and the second is that these random variables NA1 to NAM. So recall what NA is, it's the number of points that fall in the set A. So these random variables should be independent. Is this okay? All right. So what is our formal setup? Okay. So we assume that, so recall that we have a single page, right? So we have a single web page, and this web page changes at different times. Okay, and I hope you agree that the times at which this web page changes, okay, can be imagined to be a Poisson point process. So that's what we assume. So the actual times at which the given page changes is a time homogeneous Poisson point process with a fixed but unknown rate delta. Okay, so there is a rate delta which is unknown to us, but it is fixed. Okay, so of course this is also an assumption that one can ask, why is it fixed? Maybe some pages change very frequently at some times. Like for example, there may be some pages which change during daytime, but during nighttime they may not change very frequently. Like for example, the stock exchange web page and so on. Right. So indeed, that is true. But in this problem of ours, we will look at the case when delta is fixed. Okay. Now this is the times at which the page changes. Okay. Separately, we will be crawling this web page also. So we will also independently assume that, okay, there is another time homogeneous Poisson point process which tells us the times at which this web page is crawled. Is this okay? Like, so what I'm saying is that, let's say this is the timeline, okay, and let's say this is the times at which the page changes, right? However, this may be the times at which I crawl the web page. Is this okay? So there are two sequences of time instances. First is these x's and the second is these circles, right? So I'm saying that if you look at only the x's and if you look at only the circles, both can be viewed individually as Poisson point processes. Okay. Furthermore, as I said, that we only have access to partial information. So we will assume that at time tk, this is the time instance of the kth crawl of that particular web page. Okay, kth crawl of the given web page, right? So this is the time at which we crawl this web page. So we will assume that at time tk, we get to know the value of this indicator. Okay, so what does this indicator say? It says that whether the page got modified between two crawling instances. So you crawled this page last at time tk minus 1, and now you are crawling at time tk. So you don't get to know how many times the page has changed, but you only get to know whether there was at least one change or not. So this is an indicator random variable which can either take the value of 0 or 1. 0 means there was no change. 1 means there was at least one change. Okay. So now our formal goal is using...
Hello.
Yes. Go ahead, Devamita.
I have one question in the last slide.
Yes.
I'm sorry for interruption. I just need to know, like, how can the, like, first point and the second point become independent, because what I have understood is like when I search a single web page, mm-hmm. so crawling is giving an importance on my search basis, right?
No. So there has to be two things that has to be clear, right? So there is some weights that are decided based on how frequent a page is crawled. I can hear some echo, but anyways, maybe it's because you have unmuted yourself, right? Devamita, thank you. So what I'm saying is that, let's say you come up with some weights based on how frequently users crawl this page, right? So that part is used to determine the weights. Once the weights are determined, this... times at which the page change happens, and then independent of the times at which the page changes, we come up with a Poisson point process which tells us at which times we have to crawl this page. So there is a time at which the page changes, and I am saying that the times at which we crawl this page, they are independent. Now what you are saying is that, you know, there are some weights that are influenced by how frequently a request is made, right? But that doesn't in any way say that these two pages are dependent, right? So all I'm saying is that the times at which the page changes and the times at which I decide to crawl, these two random processes are independent. Does that answer your question?
Okay, thank you.
All right. Okay, and as I said, we only have access to this partial information. All right. So with this, our formal goal is the following, right? So we want to estimate delta using an online algorithm, which at time k only has access to this information. So what is the information? That it accesses the pages at time t0, t1, all the way up till tk, and it has access to values i1, i2, ik. So note that these are 0, 1 random variables. So which tells us, so i1 tells us if a page changed in t0, t1, right? i2 tells us if the page changed in t1, t2, and so on. Is this okay? So each i1, i2, ik is a 0, 1 random variable, but at time tk, you only get to know or you only can access these values. All right. Okay. So let me give some quick comments on this setup. Okay. So the assumptions that we have made are standard in literature, right? So recall that the rate at which we crawl, okay, so this is a Poisson point, or the times at which we crawl, that is a Poisson point process with rate p. So we assume that, this value, okay, either is chosen arbitrarily or using some prior knowledge. So in that setup, delta is unknown, but p is known because we choose it. Okay, so this is something that you need to keep in mind. Okay, and the other thing you have to keep in mind is that we only have access to partial information, which means that we don't know the number of times the page changes in this interval. Is this okay? All right. Okay, so one quick point. Okay, so why is this Poisson assumption on regarding the times at which the page changes is true? Okay, so for this, there are several experiments that people have already done, and we also did one such experiment to make sure that this Poisson assumption is actually true. Okay, so for that, what we did was we went to Wikipedia traces, okay, that is actually available, that is openly available, and chose an arbitrary page with this title, Template Talk Did You Know? Right. So recall that a web page is, this Wikipedia page is updated at certain time instances, and Wikipedia trace keeps a track of the times at which this particular page was changed. Okay. So then what we did was we extracted the timestamps of the page edits between April 2020 and so this should be August 2020. Sorry about that. So from April 2020 to August 2020. So this is roughly 5 months. Okay, so we extracted this information. So this information basically contains at what time instances this particular page was updated, and we noticed that this page was had changed 4043 times, right? And the mean inter update times, this was just statistically calculated, and we saw that this was 1.1098. okay, so this is basically these many days was the time between two updates. Is this okay? And then there is something called as a QQ plot. Okay, this is used to compare two distributions. Okay, so compare two distributions. So this is what a QQ plot, or what is otherwise called as a quantile plot. Okay, so in a Poisson point process, okay, one can show that the inter arrival times, like let's say these are the times of this random times at which Poisson point process generate points, right? So if you look at tk minus tk minus 1, this is what is called as the inter arrival time, or in our case it will be referring to as the inter update time, right? One can show that this is exponentially distributed. In fact, one can show that t2 minus t1, in fact t1 minus t0, t2 minus t1, T3 minus T2, all these random variables. So this, these are all sequence of random variables. These are IID random variables, and they are exponential with the rate delta. Okay, so exponential with rate delta. So since this delta is the tells us the rate at which the rate of the Poisson point process associated with the times at which this web page changes. Okay, so what we did was we collected these times, right, and we compared it with an exponential distribution with mean 1.1098, right? And so these were the data obtained from Wikipedia traces, okay? And this was the estimates obtained from exponential distribution with this mean, right? And we compared them. So for those who don't know what a quantile-quantile plot is, okay, it's okay. What you have to see is that this plot should lie very close to the 45 degree line, right? So if it lies very close, then our claim that this inter-update times are exponential, okay, with this mean, that is more or less correct. Is this okay? So the fact that this data actually lies on this 45 degree line indeed gives some evidence that our assumptions are indeed true. Okay, so we have actually done such a quantile-quantile plot. All right. Okay, so indeed that provides some evidence that the assumption that we have made with regards to our setup more or less holds true in practice, at least for certain web pages. Okay, it need not be true for all web pages, but certain web pages it is definitely true. All right. Okay, so what is the take-home message? The take-home message is that these are the three algorithms that we have proposed. Okay, so what are these three algorithms? The first is based on the law of large numbers. The second is based on stochastic approximation. And the third is based on the stochastic approximation with momentum. Okay, so this is based on stochastic approximation with momentum. Okay, so let me go over the update rules for all these three estimators. Okay, so the first estimator says that xk plus 1 is p times ik hat divided by k plus alpha k minus ik hat. So what is this ik hat? Well, it is the sum of ijs. So recall that these ijs are 0, 1 random variables where 1 tells that the page changed between two successive crawling instances. Okay, and ik hat is basically the sum of these ijs, and this is the rate at which we crawl this web page. So this is something that we know. Okay, and alpha k is some sequence, which for example you can choose to be 1 log k and so on. Okay, so what you can observe is that you have an algorithm, and this is an online algorithm. Okay, online algorithm meaning as more and more information becomes available to you, you get better and better estimates of xk. Is this okay? So that's how this algorithm behaves. Furthermore, it only makes use of partial information. So observe that it is only making use of these ijs and not the number of times the web page has changed. Okay, and why do we call it the law of large numbers? So you will see how the law of large numbers is actually invoked to derive this estimator. Okay, so this is an estimator based on law of large numbers. Okay, and then we have another estimator which is based on the theory of stochastic approximation, whose update rule looks like the following. Okay, again observe that yk is the current estimate of your delta. Okay, so yk provides the estimate for delta. Yk plus 1 is the new estimate for delta, right? And yk is your current estimate for delta, and this update rule tells you how to improve the estimates of delta, right? And this is your step size sequence, right? And again, this is the update rule. Again, observe that we are only making use of these partial information and the value of p that is assumed to be known. Is this okay? And then there is something called as stochastic approximation with momentum. Here, this update rule is very similar to the previous update rule. The only thing is that we have this additional momentum term. So observe that this part matches this part, but we have this additional momentum term, and this version is called as the heavy ball stochastic approximation. Heavy ball stochastic approximation with momentum. Is this okay? So I saw that somebody actually unmuted himself or herself, but I couldn't figure out who it was. If you have a quick question, please go ahead.
Gugan. Yes. In the first estimator, your xk, xk plus 1, is xk missing in the expression?
No. This is
the recursion is not.
So it's not a recursive formula. It's xk plus 1 is given by this. Is this okay?
Okay.
So you have everything available to compute xk plus 1. Is that okay?
Yeah. Fine.
All right. Okay. All right. Harsh, can you tell me how much time is remaining? Depending on that, I will sort of decide how much to cover.
So ideally, I think we have 10 more minutes.
Okay.
So maybe you can take a few more minutes, maybe 10 to 20 minutes. So based on that, you can decide how much you can cover.
Sure. I will maybe require some 15 more minutes from now. So let me try and cover this. Okay. So Now let me provide the main results of our work. Okay, so the main results is that we managed to show that each of these three estimators, that is xk, yk and zk, they actually converge to delta. So recall that this was the unknown rate at which a page changes, right? At which a page changes, right? So we managed to show that all our three estimators will asymptotically converge to delta. Furthermore, we have obtained some convergence rate estimates as well. That is, how quickly does xk minus delta decay to zero in expectation? Okay, so observe that I have an absolute sign over here. Okay, and one can actually see these are the different convergence rates. So let me try and quickly go over them. So the first result says that the convergence rate is order of alpha k over k, and so it's the order of maximum between 1 over square root of k and alpha k over k. Like for example, if alpha k was 1, okay, the second term will be 1 over k and the first term will be 1 over root k. As k becomes larger and larger, I hope you agree that this will be the dominating term. Okay, similarly, in the stochastic approximation case, we managed to show that the expected value of yk minus delta, it is order of k raised to minus eta over 2, where, where does this eta come from? This eta comes from the step size choice that you made, right? So this step size choice is k raised to k plus 1 raised to minus eta. So this is some constant which you pick between 0 and 1. Like, for example, you could pick k raised to minus 0.5. K plus 1 raised to minus 0.25 and so on. So whatever constant you pick, the convergence rate will be eta over 2. Okay, and then finally there is something called as the stochastic approximation with momentum algorithm as well. Okay, so there is actually some typo. This should be some different step size. I will later on describe what this step size is. Okay, so there is again some step size, right? And what we are claiming is that again, this convergence rate is k raised to minus beta over 2 if the step size, so what this step size is not clear at this point. So there is some step size. So if you choose it of the form k raised to minus beta, then the convergence rate actually will be k raised to minus beta over 2. Okay, so some quick comments on this result. So theoretically, these results show that xk, yk, zk converge to delta. Furthermore, it shows that the convergence rates of all these algorithms, in particular the optimal convergence rates for all these algorithms, is actually 1 over root n. Okay, so this can be very easily checked once you know what is the assumption on alpha k. So one can easily check that the optimal convergence rate is 1 over root n or 1 over root k. Right, and similarly for the others as well, the optimal convergence rate is 1 over root k. And using the central limit theorem, one can show that these rates are tight, meaning one cannot obtain convergence rates faster than this for these algorithms. Okay, so which means that we have actually obtained tight convergence rate estimates. All right, so over the next couple of minutes, I'll try and give you some motivation. Why did we come up with these update rules? Is this okay? So as far as possible, okay, I'll try and cover the motivation for how did we guess these update rules. Okay, so there is some intuition why the update rules have a suitable form. Okay, so let me try and do that. Okay, so as I said, we crawl the web page at times t0 equals 0, t1, t2, t3, t4 and so on. Okay, so let's denote the inter crawling time as tau1, this is tau2, this is tau3, this is tau4 and so on. Right, so one can show that the times at which the page is crawled is a Poisson point process with rate p. One can show that the intercrawling times are actual IID exponential random variables with rate p. Okay, this is something we can show. So what does this mean is that if you look at the first of these intercrawling times, and if you ask what is the tail probability, that is, what's the probability that tau1 is bigger than equal to tau, it can be shown to be e raised to minus p tau, right? And furthermore, if you ask what is the expected value of i1, okay, given tau1 is tau. So what we are saying is that, let's say this is t0 equals 0 and this is t1, and let's say this is tau1. And if I tell you that the value of tau1 is tau, that is the inter crawling time is tau, then what is the expected value of I1? So I1 recall is the indicator whether a page got modified or not. Okay, so this is a random variable which takes the value 0 or 1, right? And one can show that this conditional expectation is actually 1 minus e raised to minus delta tau. And using this, one can actually compute the expected value of I1. Okay, so the expected value of I1, okay, this is delta over delta plus p. Is this okay? So the take home message from this slide is that the expected value of I1 is delta times delta over P. Okay, so one can ask, this is what I need to estimate. Okay, if I knew expected value of I1, how would I have gone about estimating delta? Okay, so it is not difficult to see that since expected value of I1 is delta over delta plus P, delta has this formula P times expected value of I1 divided by 1 minus expected value of I1. So indeed, if I knew the value of expected value of I1, I could have computed delta. However, I don't have access to expected value of I1. Okay, so the question is, what do I do? Okay, here I can invoke the strong law of large numbers and state that expected value of I1, since these ij's are iid, right? So if you take their sample average and let k go to infinity, the strong law of large numbers shows that this actually will converge to expected value of I1, right? So since I don't have expected value of I1, but this quantity over here converges to expected value of I1, I can replace wherever I have expected value of I1 with this sample estimate for a given k, right? So if I estimate that, or if I substitute that, that's how I end up with this update rule. Is this okay? So this is a very, very naive idea. I just found a formula for delta in terms of expected I1 and use some estimator for that using the information that is available to me. And when I substituted that, that gave rise to this estimator. Is this okay? And as I mentioned before, under such assumptions that alpha k greater than 0 and alpha k over k goes to 0, one can show that xk goes to delta almost surely, right? And if additionally some additional condition is satisfied, then one can show that the convergence rate is actually given by this. Okay, so there is a typo here. It should be max of this quantity. Okay, and examples of alpha k which satisfy the above conditions include alpha k identically equal to 1, alpha k equal to log k or square root of k. Okay, and let me just give you two lines of how we go about proving this result. So the convergence of course follows from the strong law of large numbers, but the rate of convergence, for this we make use of some variance estimates of I1, okay, and some Chernoff bounds. Okay, so we use these two results to actually show what is the convergence rate. All right. Okay, so this is in some sense the main part of the talk, okay, which I'll try and wrap up in the next couple of minutes. How did we guess the form for the stochastic approximation algorithm or the stochastic approximation estimator? Okay, so how did we guess that is what I'll try and spend some time on. So for people who have some background on stochastic approximation theory, you will recall that the generic form of a stochastic approximation algorithm is this. Okay, that is yk plus 1 is yk plus eta k h of yk plus mk plus 1, where here this eta k is the step size sequence, h is some deterministic but unknown map, right? And mk plus 1 is the martingale difference sequence. Okay, so the way to interpret this algorithm is that ideally I would have liked to run this algorithm, yk plus 1 is yk plus eta k times h of yk. This is what I would have ideally liked to do. However, for some reason, I do not have access to h of y for y. Instead, what I have access to is for yk, instead of having the knowledge of h of yk, I have a noisy estimate of h of yk. Okay, so I don't know h of yk, but I have a noisy estimate of h of yk, which is denoted as h of yk plus mk plus 1. So instead of running this algorithm, wherever h of yk is there, I actually substitute the noisy estimate directly, right? And then this step size is chosen so that this noise gets averaged out, Okay, so this noise gets averaged out. Okay, so that's the whole idea of stochastic approximation theory. So this step size choice is very crucial. So if this step size choice is made carefully, okay, then the noise gets averaged out, and in the limit where this algorithm converges to and where this algorithm converges to, in the limit under some conditions, one can show that the limiting behavior is the same for both the update rules. Okay, so this is actually a deterministic update rule, whereas this is a stochastic update rule. And what we are saying is that the limiting behavior for both these update rules will be one and the same under some nice conditions. Is this okay? So one can ask, if I gave you an algorithm of this form, okay, how can I analyze its convergence? In particular, I can ask, where would such an algorithm converge to, how fast would it converge, and so on, right? So with regards to convergence, there is some method called as the ODE method. Is this okay? So under this method, where it would converge to is answered based on what is called as a limiting ODE, right? So what we do is we view this as an Euler scheme. Okay, so recall, what's an Euler scheme? An Euler scheme is a numerical approximation scheme to cook up approximation to a solution trajectory of an ODE. So we view this as a noisy Euler scheme of certain ODE. And which ODE is that? It is this ODE, right? Because I can write the above update rule as yk plus 1 minus yk over eta k equals h of yk plus mk plus 1. So this roughly is y dot of t. Okay, so this is approximately equal to h of yt plus some noise, but I will ignore this noise. Sorry about this. So I will ignore this noise, right? And this is what is the limiting ODE. So in the ODE idea, the idea is that you look at this limiting ODE, which note is a deterministic ODE, right? And I ask, what are the properties of this limiting ODE? In particular, if suppose there is a unique globally asymptotically stable equilibrium for this ODE, and let's call this as Y star. Okay, so let's say there is a unique globally asymptotically stable equilibrium for this ODE, meaning wherever I start a solution of this ODE, the solution trajectories will actually converge to Y star. Right. So then under some nice conditions, I can show that the stochastic approximation iterates actually converge to Y star as well. Okay, so let me repeat. If Y star is a asymptotically stable equilibrium for this ODE, then under some nice conditions, one can show that the stochastic approximation iterates also converge to Y star. Is this okay? So keeping this in mind, we have to cook up a nice edge function. Okay, so in some sense, this will be the second or third last slide. Okay, so please bear with me for a few more minutes. So so the idea in coming up with this stochastic approximation estimator is to cook up this H function very, very carefully. Okay, so the way we do it is the following. Let I denote a random variable with the same distribution as I1. Okay, so recall that I1, I2 are IID random variables. So I just say I1 and I have the same distribution, and I define this function over here, h of y comma I, to be I times y plus p minus p. So you may ask, why have I defined it this way? Well, I will explain why. So we define this little h to be the expected value of this capital H, and we notice that it turns out to be something like this. Okay, so now you may ask, oh, this is some algebraic formula, so what? Well, it is indeed something obtained by some algebra, but the choice of this capital H function is very, very crucial. Okay, so observe that for on the right hand side, H of delta is 0. Is this okay? H of delta is 0. Furthermore, H of y is 0 if and only if y equals delta. Is this okay? So this choice of little h, the way it was chosen, okay, was to ensure that delta is the only zero of this little h. Okay. Furthermore, if you actually run this algorithm, right, yk plus 1 is yk plus eta k times h of yk times comma ik plus 1. So this update rule will look like yk plus eta k ik plus 1 times yk plus p minus yk. Right. So you can ask, why did you choose this capital H? I chose this capital H so that it only depends on IK, YK and P, because this is the only thing that we know. Is this okay? This is the only information that we know. So we use this information to update these values of yk. Okay, so how did I choose h? Well, I had to choose to make sure two things. One is it only depends on things that I know. And the second is that if I defined h, little h, to be this, delta is the unique zero for this little h. Okay, so keeping these two things, I defined this update rule, and then when I put it in standard stochastic approximation form, I can make use of the ODE method and indeed show that yk converges to delta. Okay, and in fact, using some recent results, we actually managed to show that this is the convergence rate as well. Okay, so now comes what happens in the stochastic approximation with momentum. Well, in the stochastic approximation with momentum, we just have this additional heavy ball momentum that is added, okay, to your usual stochastic approximation algorithm. Okay, so it is known that momentum sometimes helps accelerate convergence and sometimes it does not help. So we wanted to see what is the scenario over here. So we added this additional momentum term over here and asked what is the performance. Okay, so here again there is some way that this beta case, zeta case and gamma case need to be defined. So since I'm running out of time, I'll not go into those details. So if some assumptions are true, one can show that this update rule given like this, okay, this also converges to delta. Okay, and one can in fact show that if this beta k that is defined over here, okay, if this is of this form, then the convergence rate actually satisfies this condition. Is this okay? So one note about how we go about analyzing stochastic approximation with momentum, we actually rewrite this algorithm as a 2-time scale stochastic approximation. Okay, and then we make use of existing results in literature for 2-time scale stochastic approximation to actually show its convergence. And then there is some recent work which actually talks of convergence rates of linear 2-time scale stochastic approximation. So we use those results to derive the convergence rate of a stochastic approximation with momentum. Okay, so now let me give some experimental results. So there are last two slides. So this is the last but one slide. Okay, so let me tell you what is happening. So there is a page for which the change rate is 500, which means this page changes very frequently. However, we crawl this page at a rate 3. That means we crawl this page at a very low frequency. The page changes very fast, but we crawl this page very slowly. Is this okay? So here are the performances of the algorithms that we have proposed. Okay, so delta is this actual value. Okay, so this is placed over 500. Then there is this law of large numbers estimate. This is given over here. Okay, and then this is stochastic approximation with momentum, whereas this is stochastic approximation. So from this figure, you can see that the law of large numbers estimator, which is a very, very naive idea, that actually performs very well. The stochastic approximation idea performs very poorly. However, by adding this additional momentum term, okay, we actually managed to boost the performance significantly. Okay, so that is like the take home message. Just by adding this simple momentum term, we were able to improve the performance of the stochastic approximation algorithm significantly. Okay, so that's the take home message. So this figure actually shows only one run. Okay, whereas this if I remember correctly, we did several runs. Okay, and then looked at the average error. So the average error over here is, you sort of take this xk minus delta over several runs of the algorithm and average it. Similarly, you look at yk minus delta and zk minus delta. Okay, so you look at this. So this gives a more cleaner picture of what the story is. Again, you can see that the law of large numbers estimator decays very quickly. This is the stochastic approximation with momentum, and this is stochastic approximation. Is this okay? Right. So now in the next experiment, what we do is we change the value of p. That is, we crawl more frequently. This doesn't change, but frequency at which we crawl this page is now significantly higher. Right. So in this case, you can see that the stochastic approximation algorithm also performs very well. Right. So when you crawl very frequently, right, the stochastic approximation algorithm actually is also performing very well. In fact, the stochastic approximation with momentum, which is this, actually, while it goes close to 500 very quickly, it keeps bouncing off. Right. So you can see that it has some high variance in its estimate, whereas the stochastic approximation without momentum does not have such a high variance. Okay, so again, if you take, so this is actually just one run, whereas if you do several runs and average out the error, this is the story, right? So here, you know, one can ask, did momentum actually help or not? So here, observe a nice story that unfolds, right? So until this point, right, so stochastic approximation is better, right? But after some point, okay, stochastic approximation with momentum is better, but after some point you are actually not able to distinguish whether stochastic approximation performs well or stochastic approximation with momentum performs well. Is this okay? So I can stop over here by discussing some future directions, right? So one is that at this point, this p that is there that we have kept fixed. Okay, so I think the next question that we would like to ask is, can we sort of adapt p so that eventually this p goes to the optimal crawling frequency? So right now we have chosen this p, okay, arbitrarily, and this is fixed. Okay, so we use this p to figure out what delta is, right? But once you know delta, you can use these algorithms by Azar and others, and also Avrachenko. So we can find out what the optimal value of p should be. Right, so we choose some naive value of p, and then we would like to adaptively change it to the optimal value. So that is, we would like to come up with a strategy. And the other direction that I would like to look at is, it's not clear, what is the advantage of momentum. So we looked at convergence rates, but from convergence rates the story is not clear, because the optimal convergence rate with or without momentum is the same. So we would like to ask, is there some way to figure out what is the advantage of momentum and when momentum really helps? Is this okay? So with this, let me stop. Thank you. I'd be happy to take questions. Harsh?
If anyone has any question, you can go ahead. So, okay. It seems, I think no one has any questions. So thank you, Gugan, for a wonderful talk. It was really interesting, and we got a good insight into the crawling and approximation algorithms.
Sure.
So thank you for your time. So I think we can call it a day here.
Sure. Okay. All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.